Jay Shrek Myths, Legends, and Lies. Where are we at today? Well, we're at the staging area of the Santa Fe Trail. This is where they staged to start it, basically. And it was a little bit outside of Independence, Missouri, in a town of Sibley, Missouri, which is due east of Independence. Now, in 1804, Clark Expeditions, he located this hill in 1804, and when he looked up on the hill, he said, you know what, this would be a perfect place for a fort. And guess what? They did that very thing. So I'm at the historic location of today, Fort Osage, and take a look at this. How fascinating is this? This is the recreation of the original fort. It was built on the original foundation. And, you know, I came here as a kid a million years ago. You want to talk about history? That's history, right? And so this is the recreation of the original fort. Again, on the original foundations, because this fort didn't really last that long once it got going. These soldiers made $5 a month for their service. And there was approximately, at this fort, 81 soldiers that were at this fort.
So the fort itself is really more of a trading post than anything else. There is a military component to it here, but the main reason why the fort is here is for the factory building, which is the government-run trading operation. It's government subsidized. It's a system created by George Washington and continues until 1822. And the idea is, as George Washington described it, it's essentially an economic alternative to warfare with Native Americans. The idea is to sell products to Native Americans at cost while taking in furs or other goods at market price. So that's primarily why this is here. This is primarily a commercial or diplomatic center for the United States government in its interactions with Native Americans. So that's the main reason why Fort Osage is here. At the time, it was the most western position or the most western expansion of the United States government, the most western outpost. This was the border between the United States and the Osage Nation, which was controlled everything from the west of here. That's pretty much it. It was in operation from 1808 till 1827. During that time, housed a military garrison ranging between 81 soldiers in 1808 and down to 3 soldiers in 1821. So quite a bit of fluctuation. So primarily commercial, but also with a military component.
Now that flag there that is flying now is from 1795, and this whole fort is really just fascinating and really a great place to come see. If you get a chance to come see this, I mean, you're really going to be really infatuated with the fact that how well it's been restored and what a quality restoration they've done. Now, one of the most important things, I think, now let's say that you were a soldier and you were maybe getting a little rowdy, maybe you're a little pissed off at your $5 a month pay. Well, they had a pole called the whipping pole, and the whipping post was here in the middle, and if you got caught doing something maybe you shouldn't be doing, you get 40 lashes right here at this pole right here. They didn't play back in the day. I guess that's better than hanging, but you wanted 40 at the whipping post, here's where it was.
Thank you.
Now, these are the original bunkhouses for the fort, and back in those times, they were two to a cot, right? A little more friendly than I'd like to be, but what happens at the fort stays at the fort. Thank you. You know, it's pretty amazing that they had China on the table, and you know, for in the middle of nowhere at that time. You know, it was actually the farthest Western expansion fort, but I mean, they lived fairly well. They didn't live like you might think they would. This was pretty elegant in all actuality, that the way they lived. You know, when you think of the early 1800s, I think like most of us do, you know, we mainly think about the fact that, you know, dirt floors, things like that, very rustic, very, you know, very, but, you know, look at this kitchen. I mean, even, yeah, it's primitive, but for the time, man, I'm telling you. So the Indians would bring in their furs, and then they would trade out for things that they needed, whether it be guns or whatever that might be, to make their life a little better. So the whole thought process behind this, which is really intriguing, I never thought about it, was that it was more of a peaceful trip. So it was kind of like making it easier for us to get along. Now, if you look through here, the powder magazine is where this would be, right? And so, to store the gunpowder to make sure that nothing bad happened, right, in here. Now, if you look along this line, what you're gonna find is you're gonna find an orange painted line. Now, what's incredible about that orange painted line is that this foundation below that orange painted line is the original foundation. So it's the original fort foundation. If you look below that, which is absolutely fascinating, from, you know, 1808 was when they laid these stones. That is unbelievable. One thing you notice when you come down here, this is where they would have stored the pelts if they were waiting to ship them out of here. Extremely, extremely cool. I mean, we're basically four stories down, or three stories down from the original. Now, this is where the pelt press would have been, right through here, where they'd have got the pelts prepared and ready to be shipped. There is the pelt press right there. Absolutely fascinating. This really is really an incredible place.
And a lot of Native Americans actually looked, they preferred designs like these. This one was actually known as an Iroquois cross, because they reminded them of dragonflies, which were clan symbols for a lot of Native American cultures.
So. That makes sense.
Yeah. And you can see, if you look at representations or drawings or paintings of Native Americans from the early 19th century, a lot of them have, from the 18th and early 19th century, a lot of them will have desync types of jewelry. We see these very extensively used crosses, beavers, otters.
The shell is interesting.
So that is a wampum shell. Now, wampum is very ancient, and it was used by pre-Columbian Native American societies as essentially as a kind of currency. This is the quahog wampum, or quahog shell. You can see on the inside it has this very shiny white and also purple. So what they would do is they would make beads out of them. This is actually an imitation purple, so this is white that's been dyed. But this is the white that's actually made from the quahog, or from the clam shell. in early Native American society, so pre-Columbian society, these were very traded. We find evidence of wampum shells in the American Southwest, all over the world, or all over North America. When Europeans arrive, they see the value that Native Americans put towards these beads without really understanding them to a great deal. And early European traders, of course, will then offer them things like glass beads as a way. So when you hear people talking about, Native Americans would trade land for beads, it's because beads had a very strong cultural value to them. I mean, prior to European arrival, these were essentially money. So they're willing to trade quite a bit for glass beads.
That is interesting.
The United States government, when they established the factory system here, we knew that wampum was going to be something of value. So they actually found a family that lived in New Jersey that was still making traditional wampum and hired them to supply wampum to the factory system. So
the old, it sounds funny, but the heap wampum, that's what that old saying that comes around, you know, that you hear, mm-hmm. That's really what that was. That really had a value and it really meant something.
Absolutely.
I never knew that. That's awesome. See, this stuff fascinates me. It really does.
Now, so small bowl, $10. I mean, is that if you?
That's
what it would be worth in today's
money? No, that's the modern price. I mean, most of the goods here are on sale.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay, then you can replenish it and whatnot. Make some extra cash.
Absolutely.
You don't need a pipe, do you, Lee?
Not today.
Oh, checkers.
You can use it anywhere in the United States. If you have an English silver dollar, you can use it, in anywhere the English controls. Spanish silver dollars are of such value, are such high quality, that you can use those anywhere in the world. And of course, if you need half a dollar,
oh my gosh,
you cut it in half. If you need
a quarter
of a dollar, and then if you need an eighth of a dollar or a bit, here you go.
Oh,
if you've ever heard of pieces of eight, what they're talking about is a dollar that's been cut into eight pieces, or a bit.
Oh, yeah.
So 2 bits is 25 cents.
Interesting.